Okay, so in today's notes, we're going to take a look at special right triangles. So to start, we're going to start real basic with the Pythagorean theorem. So in order to use the Pythagorean theorem, we need a right triangle. And in the Pythagorean theorem, your A or your B represent the legs. So in other words, instead of A squared plus B squared, it's leg squared plus leg squared. And our C represents the hypotenuse, so equals the hypotenuse squared. And the hypotenuse is always opposite the 90 degree angle, as it's the longest side of the right triangle, and that 90 degree angle is the largest angle. Remember, the two acute angles of a right triangle are complementary. So to start, we're going to spend some time rewriting, okay, the Pythagorean theorem in terms of the A, the B, and the C. And some of you have already seen me do this on a homework answer key, but the reason why we do this is to avoid having to show both the roots, okay? So if I write it in terms of the hypotenuse, so if you think about solving for C, so an A squared plus B squared equals C squared. If you wanted to solve for C, you would take the square root of both sides to undo the square. And the C, or the hypotenuse, is equal to the square root of A squared plus B squared. Now, if we were going to solve for the A or the B, it's the same process. So let's write A squared plus B squared equals C squared. If I was solving for A, the first thing I would do is subtract the B squared. And I'm left with A squared equals C squared minus B squared. And then last, after I've subtracted, I would then take the square root to undo the square. So the A is equal to the square root of C squared minus B squared. And that would be the same for solving for the other leg. B. So B is equal to C squared, the square root of C squared minus A squared. So in example one, we're going to find the value of A in simplest radical form. Now every time you leave an answer in radical form, this is an exact answer. Okay, so looking at the triangle there, we have this dotted line drawn to break up the triangle into two right triangles, because if the one angle is a right angle, then its supplement is also a right angle. And we know the length of the whole side is 15, and we have the missing side here is A. So in order to find A, I'm going to use the two right triangles. I'm going to start with this triangle here, and I'm going to call this leg of that right triangle X. And I know that the X is equal to, using the different form of the Pythagorean theorem above, we know that a leg is equal to the square root of the hypotenuse squared minus the other leg squared. So 15 squared is 225, 12 squared is 144. So 225 minus 144 is the square root of 81, which is 9. Now, if you remember from the reading, we have our Pythagorean triples. And the 3, 4, 5 triple works, and any multiple of that. So if we triple 3, we get 9. Triple 4, we get 12. Triple 15, or 5, we get 15. So I could have actually, in knowing your triples, you don't have to show the work. I could have just stated that X was 15, as it's a Pythagorean triple. So now that X is 9, rather. So now that I know that X is 9, and I know the whole length is 15, I can take 15 and subtract 9, and this leg is going to be 6. So now to solve for A in that right triangle, A is the hypotenuse. And the hypotenuse, A, is equal to the square root of leg squared plus leg squared. So we'll have 12 squared plus 6 squared. Now, 12 squared 144 plus 36, that gives us the square root of 180. Largest perfect square factor of 180 is 36. So I write it as the factors of 36 times 5. Taking the square root of the perfect square, A is equal to 6 radical 5. In number 2, and we're going to continue using the Pythagorean theorem, find the value of x and y. So again, with this straight line or linear pair right here, if this angle is 90, then the supplement is also 90. And rather than using the Pythagorean theorem, I am going to use a triple from the reading. So in this right triangle right here, this is the 5, 12, 13 triple. So we know x is 12. And then y, so if I need to find y, again, we're looking for it in simplest radical form, which is exact form. The hypotenuse is equal to the square root of leg squared plus leg squared. So that's equal to 12 squared plus 8 squared, the square root of that. So now it's the square root of 144 plus 64 is 208. So the largest perfect square factor of 208 is 16. And it's 16 times 13. So y is equal to the square root of 16 is 4, 4 radical 13. Okay, moving to the back. Our isosceles right triangle, or the 45, 45, 90, has some special relationships too that if you memorize, you can just put in. So in this triangle, and if it's isosceles, these two angles have to be 45 in the isosceles right triangle because the remaining two angles is 90, and 90 divided by 2 is 45. So opposite the two congruent angles would be these two congruent sides. So let's mark those. If you're given, okay, so given side n, or let's actually, instead of writing side, let's put leg n. So if I know this is n and this is n, then you can find the hypotenuse because the relationship is n radical 2. Okay? Now note, if you're given two sides, you can still use the Pythagorean theorem. Okay, you can always use a Pythagorean theorem when you have two sides of a right triangle and you need to find the third. But if we're given hypotenuse n, so if I know the hypotenuse, the relationship is, and I'll show you this down below, or prove it rather, with an example, that the legs are going to be half of n. So whatever n is, you take half, and they'll have a radical 2. So again, the sides are 1 half n radical 2. So let me show you this or prove this relationship down below. So let's use the first triangle in number 3. So it's a right triangle. This angle is 45. Add them all up, subtract from 90, and you'll have this angle is 45. And because these two angles are congruent in any triangle, sides opposite congruent angles are congruent. So as you see here, we have two sides and we can find the third using the Pythagorean theorem. So let's set it up as the hypotenuse x equals the square root of 22 squared plus 22 squared. 22 squared is 484, and 484 plus 44 is 968. Now if I had to reduce that, okay, we go to our calculator and we're looking for the largest perfect square factor, and it turns out 484 is a perfect square, so it's going to be 484 radical 2, and we know that because we just squared 22 above. Okay, so we know that 44 goes into 968 twice. Okay, so the square root of 484 is 22, and then we take the square root of that and leave the radical alone. So as you can see, this is still 22 radical 2, or the relationship above holds. So if I add another two examples off to the side, so say this is 5, this is 5, and with this one, if this is 11 and this is 11, we know that if the legs are 5, the hypotenuse is whatever the leg is, radical 2. So 11, 11, 11, radical 2. And then to prove the relationship up in the box to the right, so given the 10 is the hypotenuse, we said above that the legs are going to be half the hypotenuse, which is 5, radical 2. Okay, so to show you that, using the Pythagorean theorem or proving that to be true, that would be x squared plus x squared equals 10 squared. X squared plus x squared is 2x squared. 10 squared, 100, divide by 2. X squared is 50. Take the square root. And x equals, plus or minus, largest perfect square factor is 25. It's 25 times 2. We want to reject the negative. So we get x equals 5 radical 2. Okay? So you don't have to memorize the relationships up in the box. As you can see, for both of these examples, I used Pythagorean theorem here, and then I just used Pythagorean theorem here. Or if you memorize the relationship, you can just put the sides on there. So to add two more examples, just to reinforce this concept, if the hypotenuse is 12, that means that each leg is going to be 6 radical 2, as it's half the hypotenuse radical 2. And if this side was 8, then each leg is going to be 4 radical 2. All right, so in the last one, we're given a right triangle with a leg is x, hypotenuse is 25 radical 2. Again, this is also 45, and this would also be x. Well, you can find x by using the Pythagorean theorem, but we also know that from the relationships, for the relationship here, and then above in this box, that if we have the hypotenuse in terms of radical 2, then the lengths are just going to be whatever number is in front of the radical 2. So when the hypotenuse was 5 radical 2, each leg was 5. When the hypotenuse was 11 radical 2, each leg is 11. So let's move that down. So if this is 25 radical 2, then each leg is going to be 25. All right, so the last relationship in the triangle that we're going to take a look at is the 30, 60, 90 right triangle. Okay, so let's look at the first triangle here. So the relationship, and I believe they still give you this relationship on the SAT, opposite the 30 degree, I'm going to call that leg N, N representing some number. Opposite the hypotenuse is twice whatever that number is. And then opposite the 60 degree angle is going to be N radical 3. Okay, so whatever the side opposite the 30 degree angle is, the hypotenuse is always double. So therefore, if I give you the hypotenuse as N, we know this is double that side opposite the 30, this would be 1 half N. And then whatever this side is, the side opposite the 60 is going to be that number, so it's going to be 1 half n radical 3. And then this one we're going to fill in after we do that very last example. So let's look at example 4, that first triangle. Find the value of x and y. So given the hypotenuse of 18, we know that the side opposite the 30 is going to be half of 18. So x is 9, and then opposite the 60 is whatever number this is. So this is going to be 9 radical 3. So say we have a right triangle. I'm going to have it face the same direction. And I said that this was 7 radical 3. So whatever number's in front of the radical is going to be opposite the 30. So this is going to be 7. And the hypotenuse is double. You double 7, you get 14. The next one, so given the hypotenuse is 24 radical 3, we know that opposite the 30 degree angle is half the hypotenuse. So just writing it in words. So half of 24 radical 3, so 24 radical 3 over 2 is going to be 12 radical 3. So x is equal to 12 radical 3. Opposite the 60 degree angle, so this side right here, the y is equal to whatever that shorter leg is, radical 3. So if the shorter leg is, and when I say shorter leg radical 3, I mean shorter leg times radical 3. So if the shorter leg is 12 radical 3, when I multiply that by radical 3, we get 12 radical 9. The square root of 9 is 3, and 3 times 12 is 36. So if I draw another example, I want to have a longer leg and a shorter leg. That still doesn't look all that great. Good enough. So I'll put the 60 degree angle here, 30 degree angle here, and say I give you the hypotenuse this time, not in terms of a radical 3, but actually no, I will, because the example above gave me the hypotenuse in terms of a whole number. But let's say instead of giving the hypotenuse, I give you the longer leg. So say I give you the longer leg as 8 radical 3. Then the shorter leg is going to be whatever number's in front of the radical. So opposite the 30 is going to be 8, and then we double the 8 to get the hypotenuse of 16. Okay, last example. In this case, we're given the side opposite the 60 in terms of a whole number, when in the questions above, it was in terms of a radical 3. So given the longer leg, I would find the shorter leg. And remember, the relationship is up here in the triangle, that the shorter leg n, okay, to get the longer leg, we multiply it by radical 3. So the longer leg is whatever the shorter leg is multiplied by radical 3. So one way to do it too is to actually set this equal to, again, it's supposed to be some number, radical 3. This is probably the easiest way. So I just changed the way I was going to explain this to you. So set it equal to the n radical 3, and then just solve for n. So divide by radical 3, and we get n equals 12 over radical 3. Now, there's an issue, okay, or you cannot write your answers with an irrational denominator. So we have to rationalize it. So I'm going to move this over here. And you'll do more of this in algebra 2. But I'll introduce it here in geometry. So if I have 12 divided by radical 3, in order to rationalize it, meaning we need to get rid of the radical, we simply multiply by itself. So we multiply by radical 3, or I need to multiply the denominator by radical 3. So I don't want to change the value, so I'm going to multiply by 1. But it's in the form of, again, any number divided by itself. And in this case, radical 3 over radical 3. So we multiply fractions straight across. 12 times radical 3 is 12 radical 3. And radical 3 times radical 3 is going to give us the radical 9. The square root of 9 is 3. Dividing 12 by 3, or taking a third of 12 radical 3, we get 4 radical 3. So opposite, or n, which is supposed to be opposite the radical 30, that's our n, we just found it as 4 radical 3. So now the hypotenuse is double. You double 4 radical 3, and you get 8 radical 3. So given, I'm just going to use a yellow pen, given the side opposite the 60 degree angle as a whole number, this shorter leg is going to be a third of whatever that number is, radical 3, and then that's double. So let's go up and fill our last relationship in the table. So as I said, given the n as the longer leg, we take a third of that, so divide that by 3, and then multiply it by radical 3, and then we're still going to double, right, the shorter leg to find the hypotenuse, and when you double one third, you get two thirds. So this is going to be two thirds n radical 3. And to finish up the notes for today, we have two examples. So we have to find the perimeter of an equilateral triangle given the altitude. So I'm going to draw an equilateral triangle, and the altitude, again, is drawn perpendicular to one of its sides. So the altitude is 6 radical 3, and that's all that's given. And we just need to find one side, because all the sides are the same length. So what do we know? What else do we know about an equilateral triangle? Well, we know if it's equilateral, it's equiangular. So each angle is 60. And remember from the last unit that the altitude is a median, so it will bisect. And it also is an angle bisector. So it bisects the base, and then it bisects the vertex angle. So this is 30, 30, and look, we have one of our special right triangles. And it's in the format we like. We like the format that when opposite the 60 is given in terms of a radical 3. Because whatever this number is in front of the radical, that's our shorter leg. So this is going to be down here 6. And then now the hypotenuse is double, so 12. So the x's are 12. This would be 6, 6 plus 6, 12. And then our perimeter, 3 times 12 is 36. Centimeters. And the last one. We haven't seen the area of a regular hexagon since unit 1. So to find the area, remember we broke this hexagon up into triangles. And when we find the area of 1, we're simply going to multiply that by 6. So I'm going to take this triangle here and redraw it right here. We have the altitude. So what we need is the base, and we have the height of 18. So in order to get the base, well, we know that the distance from the center to each vertex is the same. So it's going to make this triangle isosceles. And then what else do we know? Well, we know that in any circle, we have 360 degrees, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 angles are the same. So 360 divided by 6 is 60 degrees. So this angle here is 60, but because it's isosceles and I drew the altitude, it's going to bisect this angle. So we have 30 and 30, leaving this are these two angles here at the base, 60 degrees. So given this side as 18, so it's not in terms of a radical 3. So remember, we take, for this side here, opposite the 30, we take a third of that. So a third of 18, so this is a third of 18 radical 3, which would be a third of 18, 6. Radical 3. So if that's 6 radical 3, this is 6 radical 3. And then our base, together all the way across, 6 and 6, 12 radical 3. So now I have the base and height of the triangle. So the area of one triangle is 1 half base times height. So 1 half of 12 radical 3 times 18. So 1 half of 12 is 6. And then 6 radical 3 times 18, we get 108 radical 3. But the area of the hexagon is going to be 6 times 108 radical 3. So 6 times 108 is going to be 648 radical 3. And we have inches squared. However, this question did ask us to round. So type that into your calculator. And you should get the number 1,122.368923. It's the nearest tenth. It's going to be, the area is approximately 1,122.4 square inches. So in this case, we had to round. If it didn't say to round, you want to leave your answer in exact form, which would be 648 radical 3 square inches.